I am Prashant Vishwanath Dhanshetti, Assistant Professor, Department of Civil Engineering from Walchand Institute of Technology, Solapur. Today I am here to explain you about the expression for the crippling load when one end of the column is fixed and other is free using Euler's column theory. The learning outcome of today's lecture is student will be able to study the failure of long columns. They can derive the crippling load for column when one end is fixed, other end is free. The compression member. So, the compression member may be called as column or a strut, so which is subjected to axial compressive load. So, we can have this column is a structure which is vertical and both its end fixed, which is subjected to axial compressive load. Now, how the failure of the column takes place? So, either it takes place by direct compressive stress, which is occur in case of short column, that is sigma c is equals to pc upon a, that is compressive stress is equals to compressive load divided by cross sectional area, whereas long column fails by buckling stress, that is sigma b is equals to p into e by z, where E is the eccentricity and Z is equals to I by Y. So now, some column may be failing either with the combined effect of direct compressive and buckling stress. When we will call it as a long column, features of long column. So, long column is the column which is having length to least lateral dimension ratio greater than 12. And it generally fails by buckling, and it is subjected to buckling stress, whereas radius of gyration is less for long column and the load carrying capacity is lesser. So, the failure mode is by buckling. Sign convention. So, a moment which will bend the column with its convexity towards its initial center line of the column is taken as positive. And the moment which will bend the column with the concavity towards the initial center line is taken as negative. Failure of column. How does the failure occurs in long column and short column? Here, pause the video and try to write answer on a paper. Long column fails by buckling, whereas short column fails by crushing. The expression for crippling load when one end of the column is fixed, other end is free. So, now we will consider a column of AB having the length L and cross sectional area A, which is fixed at end A and free at end B, and P is the crippling load applied. So, after applying the crippling load, the column will deflect in this shape, that is AB dash. And we will consider a section at a distance of x from A where the deflection of the column is y. Now, the moment due to the crippling load, so now this crippling load will be acting at this point. So, this load into this distance will be the moment. So, P into A minus Y. So, the moment is also given by this formula EI D2Y by DX square. So, now equating this both moment, we will get EI D2Y by DX square is equals to P into bracket A minus Y. So, this multiplying this into the bracket, we get P into A minus P into Y. So, now taking this negative term on the left hand side, I will get EI D2Y by DX square plus PY is equals to PA. Now, this can, this is divided by EI. So, what I will get is D2Y by DX square plus P upon EI into Y is equals to P upon EI into A. Now, this equation can be written as D2y by dx square plus alpha square y is equals to alpha square a, where alpha square is equals to p upon ei, therefore alpha is equals to under root p by ei. The solution of this equation is y is equals to c1 cos alpha x plus C2 sine alpha x plus alpha square A upon alpha square. So now putting again the value of alpha, we will get y is equals to C1 cos x. So now instead of alpha, here I am putting its value, that is under root P upon EI plus C2 sine x under root P upon EI plus A. So this we will treat it as equation number 1. Now we know the boundary or end condition at x is equals to 0, y is also 0, means deflection at A point is 0. Putting this in equation number 1, we get, so now y is equals to 0 and now x term is 0, means this term will become 0 and this term will also become 0. Therefore, 0 is equals to C1 cos 0 plus C2 sin 0 plus A. Now cos 0 is 1 and sin 0 is 0, so this term will become 0. So from this we get C1 is equals to minus A, that is equation number 2. Now one more condition we know, that at x is equals to 0, dy by dx, slope is also 0 at fixed end. So this is the equation, so we have to find now dy by dx. So from equation 1, differentiating, we will get dy by dx is equals to C1 minus sine x under root P upon EI into under root P by EI plus C2 cos x under root P upon EI into under root P by EI. Now plus 0, the differentiating or derivative of constant is 0. So dy by dx is equals to minus C1 under root P upon EI sine into bracket x under root P upon EI plus C2 under root P upon EI into cos x under root P upon EI. So this we will treat it as equation number 2. Now putting x is equals to 0 and dy by dx is equals to 0 in this equation number 2. So we will get 0 is equals to minus C1 under root P upon EI sin 0, as x term is 0, this will become 0, plus C2 under root P upon EI cos 0. Now, as C1 is equals to minus A, and now here 0 is equals to minus C1 under root P upon EI into sin 0 plus C2 under root P upon EI into cos 0. Now, cos 0 is 1. Sin 0 is 0, so this term will become 0. Therefore, C2 will, so for this term, now left hand side is 0. Now the remaining term is C2 under root P upon EI. So now here, either C2 must be 0 or under root P upon EI must be 0. But for crippling load, you are having a value of P. Therefore, under root P upon EI cannot be equal to 0. Therefore, C2 will be equals to 0. Now again, substituting C1 is equals to minus A and C2 is equals to 0 in equation number 1, we get y is equals to minus A cos into bracket x under root P upon EI plus A. This is equation number 3. Now again, one more condition we know, that at x is equals to L, the deflection y is equals to A. Now putting this in equation number 3, so here instead of y, I am putting here A is equals to minus A cos L under root P upon EI plus A. So now here the x value is replaced by L. So now this positive A I will take on the left hand side, so A minus A, it will become 0 is equals to minus A cos into bracket L under root P upon EI. So now for the for this term to be a 0, either A should be a 0 or cos into bracket L under root P upon EI should be 0. But A cannot be 0 because due to the crippling load, there is a deflection at the free end, that is A. So therefore A cannot be equal to 0. Therefore the second term, that is cos L under root P upon EI, should be equal to 0. Now this is equal to 0 where for the value of cos pi by 2 or cos 3 pi by 2 or cos 5 by 2. So therefore, this term L under root P upon EI should be either equals to pi by 2 or 3 pi by 2 or 5 pi by 2. Now taking the least practical value of this, so we will get L under root P upon EI is equals to pi by 2. So now taking this L on the right hand side, we will get this squaring both sides. So we are getting this equation P upon EI is equals to pi square upon 4 L square. Therefore, P is equals to pi square EI upon 4 L square. This is the crippling load. Now, what is the effective length of column with one end fixed and other end free? Now, if you see when both ends of the column are hinged, so actual length P is equals to pi square EI upon L square. So if we are using effective length, then also it is pi square EI upon L effective square. Therefore, L effective is equals to L. Now for the condition one end fixed and other end free. Now just now we have derived P is equals to pi square EI upon 4 L square. Whereas by Euler's it is P is equals to pi square EI upon L effective square. So here L effective is equals to 2 L. So these are my references which I have referred. Thank you very much for watching my video.